What we have here today is the Humani Corporis Fabrica, in English, on the workings of the human body. It is the first truly accurate book on human anatomy. It was published in a remarkable year of 1543 by a man named Andreas Vesalius. It was also the same year, by the way, that Copernicus published the Orbium Celestium. So it was really quite a year. Vesalius became professor of anatomy at a time when the supreme authority in medicine was from a man named Galen. Galen grew up in an era under Roman rule. He began to add the anatomical concept of humans to the humoral theory of medicine. And he did a lot of advances in understanding how anatomy could be connected to this natural theory of disease. But because he practiced in Roman times, human dissection was still prohibited. So he ended up inferring, although he doesn't say this in his writings, he ended up inferring a lot of animal anatomy as human anatomy, and therefore made some really egregious errors. But his personality was one where he was perhaps one of the most egotistical physicians that's ever lived. And he literally wrote that no further research is needed. All you need to do to know medicine is to read what I've written. And unfortunately, medicine drank his Kool-Aid, because he left a body of work that was deemed so conclusive that it literally inhibited any further research for at least 1,500 years. In fact, as the Middle Ages progressed, if you even criticized Galen, you could be accused of heresy and, in fact, excommunicated. Now, Vesalius had been interested, some might say obsessed, with anatomy from the time he was a kid. He found it fascinating. He dissected all sorts of field animals, was very good at dissecting. And when he studied Galen, he learned Galen extremely well. So that when he graduated from Padua, literally one day after graduation, he was made professor of anatomy. And he decided he didn't like the way he had learned anatomy. He wanted to do the dissections himself. And in fact, he was the very first professor who did his own human dissections. So as he's starting to do human dissections, he begins to have this disquieting feeling that a lot of times what Galen wrote was wrong. Galen would say it was one way, and he would do the dissection and find it was another way. And it kept bothering him. He became a very popular professor. And students from the University of Bologna invited him to come to their university to do a dissection while their professor read from Galen. So the professor's reading some part of Galen's anatomy, and Vesalius is doing the dissection, and it's different. But when he listens to what Galen wrote about this bony structure, he realizes that he's seen this structure before in an animal, and it hits him. Galen had never done a human dissection. That's why he kept seeing all these differences from what Galen wrote and what he found when he was dissecting. And it was at that moment that he decided this needs a book. And together with an artist named Stephen Jan van Kelchar, they developed this magnificent book, De Humani Corporis Fabrica. And it corrected nearly 200 errors that Galen had made in human anatomy. It's truly a magnificent book in medicine, for it is the first accurate book on human anatomy. And it's also a bit of a dissection guide. It's not just here's how anatomy is, as Galen had written, but it was a way of saying, well, if you don't believe me, here's how you do the dissection and you'll find exactly what I'm writing. So you'd think that the world would have accepted this immediately, because it was such genius. But Vesalius was attacked on all sides. Students attacked him, his faculty attacked him, and he received attacks even from his former faculty at the University of Paris. It's hard for us to imagine today how a book on anatomy would have caused this kind of violent reaction. But the best way I can say it is imagine trying to criticize the Bible. It took literally a couple of centuries for medicine to completely pull away from what Galen had written. largely, I think, because he had been the authority for so long. But this was really the start. It was an unfortunate situation that he got all these attacks. He was so angered by them that he resigned his position at Padua and literally burnt all his papers. It is fortunate that he lived long enough for people to start to see the genius of this work, because the people that followed him in as professor of anatomy at Padua recognized how important this was and began to teach with the book. What it really did, and I think this is its importance, is it really reset the center of gravity in medicine. It said, do not listen to the blind authority of Galen. Believe only that which you can observe. And it completely changed the approach that medicine took. In fact, many historians say that because of the broader significance of this book, that this is actually the most important book in the history of medicine. It's a tangible moment in time. It's a thrill every time I see it.